Now, someone we know who loves a challenge is our first guest. She's been living life on the wild side and putting her survival skills to the test in Alaska. It's only Sue Perkins.
Hey, lovely. Yeah.
Thanks for having me.
See, Sue, all of that sort of stuff, doing stuff, you know, when you get a bit old and things that you might...
What are you saying?
Well, not that you're old, but
sure.
Things... You know, things that
I'm
you would have...
35 plus fat.
35 plus fat. But, you know, things you would have might have liked to do in your 20s or you didn't get around to it, you know, and then doing them later in life. I'm imagining you're that type of person.
I did very little for the first 40 years of life. Just because crisps, really. Crisps and television. But I'm very lucky because suddenly work allowed me to go and experience these things and test my horizons and climb up mountains and get attacked by things and blow stuff up and... So that I can return home and eat crisps thinking, I've still had a really fun day and
perfect.
I've tested myself.
That's a good balance, you see,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, well, let's take a look at the latest adventure. Sue has a new series that starts tonight and it transports us 4,000 miles away to Alaska. It's all about life on the edge of civilization. But before we chat, let's take a look.
Alaska, America's last frontier.
Whoa! So beautiful.
I'm here to discover what life is really like in this great land.
Just outside the boundary, there's bear beds.
So unbelievable. I'm just trying to keep my cool.
And see if I can learn to survive in the Alaskan wilderness.
You never know what you're going to get out there.
I'm not ready for it!
Lovely. Now, Sue, let me ask you, and be honest, please. When you start conversations about a show like this, do you go in with a list of these are the places that I'd like to visit, what do you think? Or how does it all start?
Usually it's, I'm not the person... They might ask me where I'd like to go, and then they go, that's interesting. Where you are going is... and it'll often be places that they think haven't been seen enough on TV or places that viewers might want to go but don't necessarily have the means to travel to.
Right.
And that's important because you want to show people the world.
Of course.
And particularly at the moment, people don't have the cash to just get on planes and fly.
Yeah.
So I feel very, very lucky to do it and hopefully I can show corners of the world and exciting things and... Because I am just a normal, scared, not particularly fit person that just tries to push themselves a bit.
So because of that, does that mean that you have no choice but to throw yourself into everything because you're doing it for us at home?
Yeah, that. And also, I think there's something wrong with my brain in that I just have no boundaries. And I just go, yeah, no, of course you can shoot me in a warehouse in Colombia or whatever it might
be.
No,
it's amazing the stuff you do. But the thing with Alaska, you have been there before, haven't
yeah,
you? So
I
why
have.
Did you want to go back for this series?
Well, the last trip I did was travelling the ice road. So it was the world's most dangerous roads. Although when I signed up to do it, it was actually called the world's most interesting roads. And they changed it to the world's most dangerous roads in the
after
middle
you'd
of filming.
Signed up.
No, genuinely. We were filming into a blizzard on the ice road and I thought, I wonder why we're going into the blizzard. And we did nearly die. But it's one road and we were heading towards the Arctic Sea and I didn't see a lot of Alaska. I saw a lot of snow and a lot of ice road truckers. This was a chance to go to this beautiful state in the autumn and to meet the people, to meet the native communities, to go fishing, to get attacked by bears and to meet... And that particular clip you're seeing there is... an old Russian community. Wow. I don't know why I'm wearing that outfit. She really wanted
but
me to dress up
you.
In that. Well, it's my mum's happy because I'm wearing a dress. I mean, that's it. That's honestly, that's the happiest she'll have been seeing me on television for years.
But that's one of those photographs that needs to be on your mantelpiece.
Maybe it will be. I just want a mantelpiece.
Yeah.
I had mantelpieces.
I haven't heard that word for a long time. A mantelpiece. Very good.
Right,
if I said the word mantelpiece to you, would it have the same reaction as if I said modern European philosophy?
Yes. Ooh, there you go.
There you go. Ooh, yeah, nice. You put your survival skills to the test, Sue.
Yes.
There was a lot of preparation in case you did run into bears.
Yes. So I had to go to a survival school in an industrial warehouse, where, as you can see here, he punched me in the buttocks wearing
boxing gloves. So to be clear, he's the bear.
Yes, I was confused.
Was that a lot of call to HR?
There were several calls to the agent and to social services. So, yeah, bears, obviously, in the wild don't wear boxing gloves or immediately go for the buttocks. So, yes, no, I'm confused. Now I've said it out loud. I think something went very wrong in the filming there. I think what you have to do is you have to throw yourself... You work out as a bear's running towards you. What's my good hand? And then you cover that. So I'm left-handed,
right,
so you cover that.
Yeah.
Then you fall on the ground and the bear often will go for you for the fattiest part, which, for me, is the behind. And then we road tested it with a bear spray, and people will see what happened. It's not an edifying sight. I managed to spray myself in my own face with pepper spray.
Okay.
As the bear savages me.
Well, that's it, you see, because if the bear's coming and you've got your pepper spray, surely the first thing you've got to do is check the wind direction.
Well,
that's what I was trained to
bear
do.
Bear coming. Whoa, big guy. Hang on one second.
Let me just check.
Yeah, that's a northwesterly. Yeah. No, I did not do that. You're absolutely right, and you'd be smart enough to escape from a bear, but I didn't check it. I just fell over my own feet and sprayed myself in the eye.
Oh, no.
But you know, good for entertainment value.
Fun TV.
Lost in Alaska starts tonight, 9 o'clock on Channel 5.
Yeah, still to come, we'll be joined by two of the gladiators, and we've got a very special performance from Rick Astley.
Looking forward to that. But first, a spot of musical history for you. Now, we are going right back to 1985 and Live Aid, because the story of the biggest live rock event in history has been transformed, Sue, into a musical. Lauren went to meet, you've got Rick Astley, who doesn't love the Rick Astley? Nobody.
Stonker.
Yeah, it was pretty good. He was great. He belted out his latest track, Driving Me Crazy, from his latest album, and here he is.
But you're driving me crazy, just being my baby. Yeah, you're that kind of lady. You're driving me crazy.
Such a lovely bloke.
He is so nice.
He really is.
Yeah, we love Rick Astley.
Rick also performed a cover of Driver's License by Olivia Rodrigo, and we'll be able to see that in full at the end of tonight's show. And after he'd recorded his performance, I sat down with Rick and we had a quick chat, and this is what he had to say about playing the Maida Vale Studios with the BBC Concert Orchestra.
The orchestra thing is amazing. I've done it a few times in different parts of the world, all the rest of it, and it's just every time you walk in the room, you go, this is amazing. This is how it should be. So, yeah, it's just gorgeous.
How was Glastonbury? We've got to talk about that iconic performance. You did one with Blossoms,
indeed,
where you did Smith covers.
Indeed.
And then you did one with your own stuff.
Glastonbury is obviously one of those moments in anyone's career, I think. I'd never done it before. And because we did the two sets, that was fantastic as well. The whole day was magical. The whole weekend was magical, to be honest. It really was. And I got to have a good look round. And we've kind of said, my wife and I, that we're going this year. I'm not performing, obviously, but we're going anyway. We just want to go and soak it up.
And New Year's Eve, of course.
Oh,
we
can't
not chat without talking about New Year's Eve. That was huge.
It was so good fun to do it. And again, we did lots of different things and kind of odd things and all the rest of it. We had some guests as well, obviously. Rylan obviously was there and Charlene. We had an amazing gospel choir with us as well. I love just throwing myself in, to be honest. I like just diving in and seeing what happens. And obviously doing this thing, the BBC Orchestra, is just gorgeous, like I say. And I'm up for it. I want to enjoy it.
Yeah, 100%. And you're not shy of a cover version, which I think is why people have literally fallen head over heels for the Rick Astley show, because you do so many different cover versions.
We do. And I think sometimes it's good to have them in your back pocket. You know, if you're doing, especially like when you do like a smaller gig, like a charity gig or something like that, that's not my audience. I'm here to entertain them. Do you know what I mean? But even if you're out at Glastonbury, it's like, let's play Harry Styles. At least that'll get everybody, you know what I mean? That'll get everybody jumping.
You got me fired up.
Hey.
I'm ready for the tour.
Let's do it.
Rick, thank you very much.
Thank you, my love.
Oh, it's lovely that he's going to Glastonbury now with his family, isn't it?
As a fan, yeah.
He's just like so normal.
He absolutely smashed it last year. He was so good. Rick is going to be on tour from the 22nd of February, and we'll see his performance of Driver's License at the end of the show.
Yeah, that'll be good. Now then, you, Sue, conducted the BBC Concert Orchestra, didn't you? As part of a programme.
Yes.
And then didn't you go on to do that? It was Maestro, the programme's called, but you went on to do it in real life, didn't you?
Yeah, I really like it. I wouldn't say I'm any good at it, but I did conduct after, I conducted with that band, and they are extraordinary. They were very, very nice to me. We did a couple of Friday nights, music nights, and yeah, it was really good fun. They're so good.
Gosh.
And with Rick as well, that will be a sensational listen.
Yeah, it's
so
really
talented. Oh, yeah, I'll just casually start conducting.
just waving.
There is more music on BBC One tonight, because the Mobos are on straight after Graham Norton.
Yeah, it's going to be a great show. DJ Target from Radio 1 Extra will be bringing you all the backstage coverage, glamour of the red carpet, and performances from loads of artists like Getz, Sugar Babes, Soul to Soul, and many, many more.
Yes, and then tomorrow night, millions of us will be glued to our tellies to watch Contenders battle it out against the Gladiators. Now, before I challenge Vernon to an arm wrestle with Nitro and Diamond, let's have a look at them in action.
That's not the deal.
Get ready.
Gladiator! Hey!
please welcome Diamond and Nitro. Welcome.
Intimidate me, you beautiful people.
No. Oh, this is funny. Sue Perkins and a gladiator sandwich.
I'm telling you what, I am loving the moves there, Diamond and Nitro. Welcome. You are absolutely stacked, my friend.
Yeah, I'm sorry. It's just the way I was built and born.
That's...
This just happens when I talk, you know?
If I had a different bra on, I could do that for you right now. I'm not saying you'd like it.
Nitro, you're a fan of the jump. Yeah. Can you demonstrate?
Oh, yeah, you saw the jump. So obviously, yeah. You know, I might jump out of spaces, you know, camera frame, whatnot.
Okay.
It's just an explosion of explosive power. So I'm going to go up in 3, 2, 1. And off I go. So, you know, we can channel different sorts of energy through us. You know,
wow.
Gifted by the gods. Superhuman, isn't it? It's ridiculous.
Yeah. What do you have a signature move?
So I have the diamond pose.
Nice, we like
that. Nothing as explosive as that, but that's what we've got to do.
And I was saying to Vernon, we absolutely love the show in our house.
Huge.
Because you know, and it's one of the few shows that you can watch with the children and they absolutely love it. What's the reaction been like then, Diamond?
It's been absolutely incredible, amazing. Everyone's been so positive. But this week, everyone has been asking me about the shoe. About throwing the shoe.
Yes. Yeah. Shoe gate.
Oh, shoe gate, yeah. Very much so. But passionate about the games and we're gladiators. We want to win.
Cool. Prior to each game, do you get really competitive?
Yeah.
Do you get really focused? Nitro, you're an Olympic athlete anyway, so you know about getting psyched up and ready to race. But this is different, isn't it?
It's different in the sense of things because, you know, you want to enjoy yourself. You know, this is a celebration of who we are and what we've done. But at the same time, we're there as a test. You know, the contestants need... We need to be equal to both, so we need to go as hard on both. Do you know what I mean? You know, we've got to give them both.
Your eyes changed then.
Yeah, I went serious then.
Yeah.
I saw that. It was kind of...
Pretty powerful being in the middle of this energy.
Are you channeling the energy?
Yes, I'm sort of the sort of very limp innards to quite an extraordinary sort of pumped up sandwich.
You know, you were talking about the contenders, and some of them are, well, they're all fantastic because some of them are outstanding, aren't they? Who do you think, Diamond, has been the biggest rival for you in terms of contenders so far?
I would say Bronte. She gave me a bit of a run for my money on Jewel. She gave some good hits, but she took some good hits as well. So, yeah.
Do you call that the cotton bud game as well?
Not quite. The people say,
Jewel sticks.
Yeah, I know, right?
That's the game that you play at home where all your pottery goes literally everywhere. Everything that you've
got on the
shelf.
That's the one the kids love to play at home.
It's really exciting. Nitro, who do you fear the most when it comes to contestants?
Contestants? You know what? I really liked Finn. Finn had, like, such good energy, but at the same time, I don't really fear any of them. Like, let's be real. Obviously, like, when you look at what you've done and what you've achieved...
Do you mean when you look in the mirror?
There's one right there. I'm just looking at it.
I ain't gonna lie. If I was built like you, I'd be in hot pants every day.
Do you reckon? We've got to get you on the show.
Yeah. Can you get you your own outfit?
Yeah, we'll get you in one of these.
I look like a giraffe in a rubber band.
Honestly, I look like bubble... You take my clothes off, it's bubble wrap. It's just basically bubble wrap. I couldn't... Just respect to you guys. It's very intimidating for me right now.
Before you film, do you get to practice on the course? Because the contenders obviously do. Do you get to practice and do you go hard or do you hold back a little bit?
We haven't got to do the eliminator, but we have got to practice against each other. But we go 50%. We save the 100% for the contenders. So.
And during the run of the show, were you still training? Diamond, were you still working out or relaxed a little bit?
Relaxing a little bit, but in between... obviously takes and stuff. We did go in and do some training sessions together.
All right. Is there a bit of competition in the squat rack?
Of course.
100%. Yeah.
Everyone's sizing each other up. It can't be helped. I mean, at the end of the day, when you bring so many egos into one space, you know, everyone wants to one-off each other. There's a bit of ego lifted, but it's supportive at the same time.
Yeah,
and it's in a safe environment. We all know what we're doing. We come from different backgrounds and it actually helps us because at the end of the day, like you said, I'm an Olympic sprinter. We've got, you know, NFL players. We've got CrossFitters. We've got bodybuilders. There's a wealth of knowledge there that we can all lean on. So it's awesome.
Yeah. Nice.
I'm suddenly sitting up now.
Yeah, me too.
Bloody so one question about the Gladiator. Do you eat crisps?
Yes. So, oh, my God, I love red breast and mini cheddars. Okay. Sorry.
Just quickly, Gladiator's on BBC One and iPlayer tomorrow night at 5:50.
Yes.
Right, that's it for tonight. Thank you very much to Sue, Nitro and Diamond.
I'll be back on Monday with Rick Stein. The stars of the brilliant drama, Ken, plus the Women's FA Cup quarter-final draw will be happening right here. She's a liability, isn't she? Thank you so much as well.
Oh, it's been an absolute joy. But as promised, here is that TV exclusive of Rick Astley performing at Olivia Rodrigo's Driver's Licence. Have a great weekend.
Yeah, have a great weekend. Bye.
Got my driver's license last week, just like we always talked about. 'Cause you were so excited for me to finally drive up to your house. But today I drove through the suburbs trying, 'cause you weren't around. And all my friends are tired of hearing how much I miss you, but I kind of feel sorry for them, 'cause they'll never know you the way that I do. Yet today I drove through the suburbs and pictured I was driving home to you. And I know we weren't perfect, but I never felt this way for no one. And I just can't imagine how you could be so okay. Now that I'm gone, I guess you didn't mean what you wrote in that song about me. 'Cause you said forever, now I drive alone past your street. Forever now I drive alone past your street. Yeah, you said forever now I drive alone past your street.